لله رب العالمين ثم الصلاة والسلام على أشرف الأنبياء والمرسلين حبيبي وحبيب إله العالمين أبي القاسم محمد
اللهم صل على محمد وعلى محمد
وعلى أهل بيته الطيبين الطاهرين المعصومين الذين ذهب الله عنهم الرجس وطهرهم تطهيرا
اللهم صل على محمد وعلى محمد
قال الله العلي العظيم في كتاب كريم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم يوفون بالنظر ويخافون يوما كان شره مستطيرا ويطعمون الطعام على حبه مسكينا ويتيما واسيرا إنما نطعمكم لوجه الله لا نريد منكم جزاء ولا شكورا فوقاهم الله شر ذلك اليوم ولقاهم نظرة وسرورا صدق الله العلي العظيم
اللهم صل على محمد وآل محمد
We are during the days of Ayyam al-Fatimiyya, salamullahi alayha. And our ajaba opened the door of talking about Zahra alayha salam. I think it's important to say something about her. But this afternoon or this evening, I would like to speak about more about what she says in a khutbah that is known among the ulama, the khutbah that she gave in the Masjid al-Nabawi. But before I speak about her and what she said in khutbah in that masjid, according to the narration, Zahra alayhi salam, as you know, all her life, she was not like other women who always been seen outside. That was not a custom of Zahra. She was one of the women which Quran says, وَقَرْنَ فِي بُيُوتِكُنْ She was always at home, serving her children and her husband. That was what she was doing. But a lady like this, to see her one day, she comes out to speak in public, there is always a reason behind it. Why would Zahra, who normally nobody sees her, and suddenly one day comes, she come in the public, whether it's men and women, and she gives that talk, there have to be a reason. Now, the first lesson that I want us to learn from Zahra alayhi salam is one important message she wants to give us, is to learn to defend al-haq. No matter what happens, haq, a truth, must be defended. Even if it costs anything, everything, we have to defend the truth. If we fail at any point in our life, we fail to defend the truth, there is consequence of it. What is it? From the Quran. Allah tells us, when a person sees the truth, I hide the truth, I didn't speak up, I didn't stand for the truth. Allah tells us in the Quran, إِنَّ الَّذِينَ يَكْتُمُونَ مَا أَنزَلْنَا مِنَ الْبَيِّنَاتِ مِن بَعْدِ مَا بَيَّنَّاهُ لِلنَّاسِ فِي الْكِتَابِ أُولَٰئِكَ يَلْعَنُهُمُ اللَّهُ There is la'an, curse from Allah to those who see the truth and they don't say anything about it. That is not the first, that's the first thing. Then the second thing Allah said, وَيَلْعَنُهُمْ اللَّعِنُونَ Then on top of that, there is اللَّعِنُونَ special angels and creatures Allah created, their job is to curse those who deserve, and the first group of people they curse are the ones who hide the truth. That is one of the lessons from Zahra. So when Zahra came out, she didn't come, because a lot of things that you see in the history, they said, no, Zahra came to defend her father. Zahra came to defend her inheritance. No, no, Zahra came to defend something more important than that. And which is to defend the haq and the truth. That is the first message. Now, the second thing about Zahra alayhi salam, that when Zahra came to speak the truth, she also taught us one important message. That when you come to defend the truth, you have to abide by the Islamic teachers. You know, this is very important, brothers. You know, sometimes I want to defend the truth, right? But the method that I take to defend the truth is haram. Which in Islam, in Arabic, they call it غاية الغاية لا تبرر الوسيلة. I have a good aim that I want to do something right. But if the method to do the good things is wrong, Islam says don't do it. I'll give you an example. I said, I see an orphan, they need help, but I have to rob someone to help them. Right? I'm going to rob a bank so I can help a needy. Islam says, no, it's haram, you can't do that. So, no, I'm going to help the needy. Say, yes, but the process of helping is haram. Islam says, I don't want that help. I want to go and speak the truth. Right? But the way to speak the truth has to be maintained within the Islamic teaching. Az-Zahra alayhi salam. The reason why I'm saying this, you know, a lot of people, they say we are activists. Right? We speak the truth. But they are not binded by the Islamic teachings. That is not a true activist. A true activist is, I'm abide by the teaching of Islam from head to toe. And one of that message from Zahra is when she was going out to speak the truth, one of the Islamic teachings she was binding by it is she was fully covered in hijab. And Quran and that narration said, خرجت الزهراء وعلى رأسها خمارها. الخمار من الحجاب. When she went out to speak the truth, she made sure, yes, I'm going to defend the truth, but if I'm going to go out there without a hijab, even though I'm speaking the truth, but that defeats the purpose. So she made that she was in the full hijab. And amazing. Now this is from the historians, right? They say, خرجت تمشي مشية أبيها رسول الله. When she was walking, those who saw her, they said her walking reminded us the walk of Rasulullah. And that takes us to another point also. When Rasulullah said, Fatima tu bada'atu minni, she's part of me. It's not just by the skin. In every single part of his life, she took that message from the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, including the walk. That is Zahra alayhi salam. And as she walked into the masjid, she went and sat on the minbar. Right? Now look at the history. They said, فَلَمَّا جَلَسَتْ, when she sat on the minbar, أَنَّتْ. Right? التَّعَنِّي in Arabic is to make a sound like you feel something heavy. Which means she wants to make a point that there is so much to say in my heart. And that إِنَّ, that the Arab, they said, أَجْهَشَ الْقَوْمُ لَهَا فِي الْبُكَاءِ. That itself made people to start crying. Because they reminded, that incident reminded them the Prophet. And what did she do? She was quiet until everybody was quiet. Everybody calmed down. Then she started to speak. You know, I really urge all of us, right, when we get a chance, please read the khutbah. That khutbah is known as Jama' wa Shamil. Nothing Zahra alayhi salam didn't talk about. Number one, she talked about usul al-deen. You see, it's in there, in details. Then she comes to talk about furu' al-deen. And what is more important about furu' al-deen when she discussed, she goes to tell you some of the hikmah, which inshallah I'll share with you some of them. Al-hikmah behind it also plus all the details. Then she goes to talk about what? About Yawm al-Qiyamah, al-Hisab, what will take place, what will happen. Then she goes to talk about reasoning with the first Khalifa, about what happened, with the Fadak, her rights and inheritance. She speaks about all of that. Then she talks about also the lifestyle the people used to be in before Islam. Just history, right? How they used to live, and how the Prophet, her father, came and changed the whole thing. She talked about that too in the khutbah. Then she talks about also the knowledge of Imam Ali alayhi salam. How Imam Ali is supposed to be the most knowledgeable of all of them. And she mentioned that also in that khutbah. And so on and so forth. But just part of it. After she started the khutbah with the praise of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, she started also to talk about furu' al-deen. The first thing she mentioned about furu' al-deen, al-iman. وَجَعَلَ اللَّهُ الْإِيمَانَ تَطْهِيرًا لَكُمْ. Allahu Akbar. That Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has created iman for you to purify you from shirk. تَطْهِيرًا لَكُمْ مِنَ الشِّرْكِ. Now, let's break this a little bit, brothers and sisters. You know, the way the Prophet Zahra alayhi salam was talking, وَجَعَلَ اللَّهُ الْإِيمَانَ لَكُمْ تَطْهِيرًا لَكُمْ مِنَ الشِّرْكِ. That Allah created iman to purify you. Purify from what? From darkness. Because you purify something which is impure, right? Now, the purification that she's talking about here is not purification by water, like najasa. You do tathir with the water. No, here she's talking about tahara, or purification, fi muqabil al-dhulm. Al-dhulm, which is darkness. Because you know, in Islam, we have al-dhulm, and then dhulm and what nur. There's darkness and there's nur. Now, if a person wants a nur, you have to go with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. If you decided to go with the dhulumat, then you're not gonna get the nur from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Because the nur can only be obtained from Allah. And that can start from where? From believing in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And that is why in Surah Al-Baqarah, when we read Ayat Al-Kursi, we said, Allahu waliyu alladhina amanu yukhrijuhum min al-dhulumat ila nur. Right? What Allah does when you become a believer, He takes you from the darkness and brings you to the lightness. Right? Now the opposite is وَالَّذِينَ كَفَرُوا أَوْلِيَاؤُهُمُ الطَّاغُوتُ يُخْرِجُونَهُمْ مِنَ النُّورِ إِلَى الظُّلُمَاتِ. The iman gives you the lightness, the nur. And that's what Zahra is saying. Because when you look at the back, when the Zahra said تَطْهِيرًا مِنَ الشِّرْكِ, because before Islam, the people were completely in dhulumat. They didn't know what Allah is. They used to worship idols. They used to sacrifice for idols until Allah sent them Prophet Muhammad, who came and brought them from that darkness to the lightness. And any person who is not in that lightness, light of Allah, completely is going to be in darkness. Not in just in this world, huh? Even Yawm al-Qiyam. Now you go to example, Yawm al-Qiyam in the Quran, Allah tells us that when we leave in barzakh, in our graves, going to Ard al-Mahshar, right? There will be two individuals. Some people, they will have nur on their face. Some people, they will have completely darkness. They cannot see their way. And they will say to the others, "Undhuruna naktabisu min nurikum." Take a look at us, so we can benefit from the nur on your face. Then the mu'minin will turn and tell them, "Irji'u wara'akum faltamisu nura." So you have to go back to where? To this dunya, which is impossible, to get the nur that we have. Because this nur didn't come from here. It came from where? From alam al-dunya. That is the nur that Zahra is talking about. But she said, وَجَعَلَ اللَّهُ الْإِيمَانَ تَطْهِيرًا. It purifies you. From what? مِنَ الشِّرْكِ. Because a shirk is darkness. That is the first thing she said about usul al-deen, furu' al-deen. Then she goes to talk about also another one, as-salat. وَجَعَلَ لَكُمُ الصَّلَاةِ
تَنْزِيحًا لَكُمْ مِنَ الْكِبَرِ.
Allah Akbar.
See Salat? We pray 5 times a day. We say Allah said it's wajib, that's it. But what is the hikmah that Allah has created Salat and made it wajib upon us? Zahra tells us one of the wisdom of behind why Allah prescribes Salat is to eliminate the arrogance in us. You know, every person, every one of us, we have arrogance in us. Every group, doesn't matter, right? At some point, there is something called al-kibar, arrogance in us. But you know, what can eliminate that arrogance in you? Salat. How? Now, give you an example. Brothers, as we sit in this masjid, all right? Our clothes that we wear is not the same prices, right? There's difference. Some of us, we buy our clothes from Walmart. Some of us, we buy at Kohl's. Some of us, we buy from expensive stores. Because depending on how much you make and how much money you have. So there's differences, right? Whether we like it or not, there's differences. Now, when we go outside, the cars we drive, there's differences, right? Now, I look at this, I make more than him. I have more than you. He has more than us. There is differences. But the moment we come into Salat, all of that is gone. How? Now we walk in. We want to do Salat to the Jama'ah. Right? The first thing we do is to line up equally in the same line. I can't say I make more, so I have to stand in the first line. No, there's no such thing in Islam. I can't say, no, you have to stand back because you make less. No, every one of us, we stand in the same line equally. Is that all? No. Then we all go to ruku equally. We go to sajda together. There is no differences in salah. Because in the sight of Allah, you're all equal. That is one of the way the salah takes that arrogance in us. Not only that, then every human being, with the ego that you have, with all this that you think about yourself, Allah tells you the most precious, the most honored part of you is your face. There is no part of your body which is honored and respected like your face. And that is why Allah put it on top of every part of your body. The head is on top because the head is the best place in your body, right? That is why even when Quran wants to talk about a human being and some precious part, Allah used the word wajh. When Allah talks in Surah Al-Rahman, right? It says, "Kullu man alayha fan, wa yabqa wajhu rabbik." Everything is subjected to perish, except the face. But that is not the face, means Allah has a face, but it's an expression, because that is the highest part of human being. Now here, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells us, this part of your body, which is the most precious, the most honored part, Allah said, I want you to put it on the least thing on the planet, which is the earth, to show your humility and humbleness to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Not only one time. See, when you come to Salah, a ruku is one time in every rakah. But sajda, which is the total humbleness, Allah said, it has to be done twice. Because Allah wants to teach us how to be humble in front of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Zahra alayhi salam, she mentioned, I said, وَجَعَلَ اللَّهُ لَكُمْ الصَّلَاةِ also تَنْزِيهًا لَكُمْ مِنَ الْكِبَرِ. So to eliminate that ego. That is why a person who prays, Allah is the most humble person in Islam. A person who has Allah and Iman, it puts you humble down. If you see a person who is arrogant, then he has empty inside the heart. And there's one beautiful example some of the scholars give. They say, have you seen a tree? Right? A tree, when there's so many fruit on top, what happened? You see the branches all down because there is so much to carry, right? But the tree, if there is nothing on that tree, what happens? You see the branches all up. Similarly to human beings. A person with Iman and is always down. A person with emptiness, he wants to raise himself. That is the difference. So Zahra alayhi salam, she tells us, وَجَعَلَ اللَّهُ, the Salat was prescribed so we can be humble. Not just in front of Allah, in front of others. That is what Salat does. Right? Then she go into the details. What's Zakat?
تَنْمِئَةً لِأَمْوَالِكُمْ Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala also prescribed the zakat to purify your risk and your sustenance. And she going to keep it.
As she went through the line, then she come to talk about her right that was taken. What is her right? The earth, the inheritance. Because what happened historically is that the first Khalifa told Zahra alayhi salam that you have no right to the inheritance from your father. Zahra asked why? The answer was, because I heard the hadith of the Prophet where the Prophet says, نَحْنُ مَحْشَرَ الْأَنْبِيَاءِ We the group of Prophet, La nurath, we are not, nobody inherits us. Ma taraknahu sadaqa. Whatever we leave behind, it's a sadaqa. Nobody can inherit. That was the argument that was made towards Zahra alayhi salam. Ya Zahra, you have no right to claim the inheritance from your father because your father is a prophet and no prophet can be inherited. That was about Umar, right? Now listen to Zahra alayhi salam. What is her argument? And you will be shocked that Zahra alayhi salam, she goes not from the Quran, she goes also from the fiqh as well to prove a point. The first one from the Quran, she says, Isma, Ya Aba Quhafa, Abi Kitab Allah Taritu Abak Wala Aritu Abi. How come you get to inherit your father and the book of Allah and I don't get to inherit my father? If the book was revealed for everybody, you get to inherit your father based on the Quran says, right? And I don't get the right to inherit my father. Why? What's the reason? And if you say what you say, let me tell you what Allah said in the Quran. They said, where are you with the ayah? وَوَرِثَ سُلَيْمَانُ دَوْدَ The first reason is just said, look, you read the Quran, right? Allah said to us, right? That Dawood, alayhi salam, a prophet, when he died, his son Sulaiman inherited everything from his father. How can he get inheritance and the child? Sulaiman inherited his father, and you're telling me the prophets cannot inherit. And that the children, whatever the prophet leaves behind, nobody can inherit them. She doesn't stop there. She wrote another ayah. She said another ayah also. Zakaria said, Rabbi habli. Allah, give me a son. Yarithuni wa yarithu min ali Yaqub. Ya Allah, grant me a son who will inherit me and inherit like the family of Yaqub. Not only that. Now this, someone can say, okay, the first one is about the prophet. The second one is about the prophet. Is there any ayah that generalizes inheritance from every child, from every father to his child? Yes, the ayah that Zahra alayhi salam mentioned, she says, Allah yaqul fi al-Qur'an lil-dhakari mithlu haddal. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala made it clear that when a person dies and he leaves behind both boys and girls, they have the right to inherit their father. Both of them. There's nothing to stop them. They have the right to inherit. Why is it that I cannot inherit when these ayahs were all mentioned? That's the from the Quranic part. Then she goes to the field. And then she said, أَوَلَسْتُ أَنَا وَأَبِي عَلَى مِلَّةٍ وَاحِدًا Is it me and my father? We're on the same religion. Allahu Akbar. That's from the fiqh. Right? He said, is it me, Fatima, and my father, Rasulullah, on the same religion? Because, why is she making this reasoning? Because in Islam, right? If a father and the son are not on the same religion, there is no inheritance between them. Meaning, if the father is a Muslim, the son is not a Muslim, the father can inherit the son, but the son cannot inherit the father. If the opposite, the son is a Muslim, the father is not a Muslim, the father cannot inherit the son who's a Muslim, but the son can inherit the father when he dies, because there is that inheritance between them. From the one side, but not the other side. But if they both are on the same religion, then there is no reason to inherit each other. And that's what Zahra alayhi salam was making the reason. أَوَلَسْتُ أَنَا وَأَبِي عَلَى مِلَّةٍ وَاحِدًا Because in Islam, as you know, there are only two reasons that prevent someone from inheritance. Two things, and that's it. More than that, there is nothing you can do to prevent your son from inheritance. Or to prevent your daughter from inheritance. Because sometimes some people say, I have a daughter, I have a son, but they're not listening to me. They're not even taking care of me. Can I exclude them from inheritance? Islamically, no, I'm sorry, you cannot. My son is disrespectful. Can I
Can I write a will for him not to inherit?
Sorry, no, you cannot. The only time you can stop your son Islamically not to inherit, if two things happen. One, if they change their religion, right? That is one reason. The second reason, the second reason is called al-qatl. If a person supposed to inherit, right? There's inheritance between the two, and one of them kill another, there's no inheritance between them. That killing stops them and prevent them from inheriting that person that they killed. So Zahra alayhi salam, she was making this point. And then she goes to make about Imam Ali. I said, Am antum a'lam min abi wa ibn ammi bi khusus al-Quran wa umumi. I said, oh, you know more about Quran than my father and my husband Imam Ali alayhi salam. Allah. Because she wants to tell them that whatever you try to say about Quran, Rasulullah knows more than you and Imam Ali knows more than you. That was Zahra alayhi salam. She was making that point. Zahra, she didn't stop there. Then she goes to talk about the history. She reminds them about how the life used to be before her father. They say, وَكُنْتُمْ تَقْتَادُونَ الطَّرَقْ. So remember before my father, when you were into alcohol, and you know, brothers and sisters, historically, one of the biggest things among the people of that time was what? Was the alcohol. But even Islam, when Islam came, Islam could not stop the alcohol immediately. Islam has to take them into different stages. Because alcohol was a big thing among them. Some historians say some of them, they used to get drunk for days, they don't even know where they are. Days, because they used to drink the thick one that can take your mind for days. And to the point, even after Islam prescribed the salah, they still continue to drink. Where Allah said in Surah An-Nisa, Ya ayyuha alladhina amanu la taqrabu salata wa antum sukara. They say, make sure that when the time of salat comes, you become sober. Hatta ta'lamu ma taqulun. Because some of them, when they come, they don't even know what they were saying. Because they were completely blank. They don't know what they say in the salah. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala told them. So some of them, before the salah, they try to make sure they don't drink, and they drink after salah. Some of them even drop the number of the glass of the wine that they drink to less than as much as they got. And this continued for a certain time. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala brought another ayah. Innama al-khamru wal-maysuru wal-ansabu wal-azlam rijsun min amal al-shaytan fajtanibu. Allah automatically came and forbid the alcohol completely. And not only Allah forbid it, Islam came and called alcohol Ummul Khaba'ith. Ummul Khaba'ith. One of the worst things you can ever think in Islam is alcohol. Alcohol is the worst thing ever. And Imam Al-Hasan Al-Askari alayhi salam. He talks about the alcohol and the danger of alcohol. He said, when you put all the muharramat in one room, he said, the key of it is what? Is alcohol. If a person wants to do something bad, right? You get alcohol, done deal. You can do anything you want to do. Because at that point, you lose your sense, your mind. You can do every bad thing. That is alcohol. That is why when you go to fiqh, they tell us, every stage of alcohol was haram. La'anallahu sani'a. Allah has cursed the person who makes the alcohol. Wa la'anallahu shariba. And Allah cursed the one who drinks it. Wa la'anallahu hamila. The person who carries it from one location to another. Wa la'anallahu ba'i'a. Allah cursed the person who sells the alcohol. Wa la'anallahu mushtari. And Allah cursed the person who takes the money. And so on and so forth. Allah cursed every stage of alcohol. Because it's the worst thing in Islam. But this was the big thing back in those days. Zahra alayhi salam, she was reminded. She said, وَكُنْتُمْ تَقْتَادُونَ التَّرَقْ فَأَنْقَذَكُمُ اللَّهِ بِأَبِي مُحَمَّدٍ. Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sent someone to you to protect you. Who is that person? My father Muhammad. That was Zahra alayhi salam. She spoke so beautiful in that khutbah that more than you can imagine. there is one out of the drop of the ocean of Zahra alayhi salam. But one thing also I want to emphasize about Zahra alayhi salam is to go back and see her ziyarah. You know, her ziyarah also tells who is Zahra alayhi salam and how Imam describes Zahra alayhi salam. One of the things that Imam describes her is that Imam Sajjad alayhi salam, when he talks about Zahra, Imam Ja'far al-Sadiq says, نَحْنُ حُجَجُ اللَّهِ عَلَيْكُمْ. We, Ahlul Bayt, we are the proof of Allah upon all the creatures. Everyone. Humans and animals, everyone. Then he says, وَالزَّهْرَى حُجَّةُ اللَّهِ عَلَيْنَا. Zahra is the hujjah of Allah upon Ahlul Bayt. You know how deep this is? You know how deep this is? Imam Ja'far al-Sadiq is saying, Allah chose us to be your hujjah upon you, Yawm al-Qiyamah. But then Allah chose. You know, here, this is what to tell you that, you know, upon every boss, there is boss. Every boss, there is boss, right? Now, Ahlul Bayt alayhi wasalam, they are considered the leaders, the bosses on us. But he says, when it comes to Zahra, she is our boss. And that's why Imam Ja'far al-Sadiq, anytime he hears the name Az-Zahra, he stands out of respect for Imam for Zahra. She's not there to see him. But anytime she met Az-Zahra, he always stands out of respect for him. That is Imam Ja'far al-Sadiq. Now this Imam, when he talks about her in the ziyarah, part of the thing he mentioned is Ayyatuha al-Mumtahana. Allahu Akbar. Mumtahana means what? The one who got tested. First of all, we all get tested. Everyone, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created this one, this world for test. خَلَقَ الْمَوْتَ وَالْحَيَاةِ لِيَبْلُوَكُمْ. It is all of us. But why would Imam mention testing for just Imam and for Zahra alayhi salam? أَيَّتُهَا الْمُمْتَحَنَ. The one who was tested. And he doesn't stop there, right? And he goes to says, اِمْتَحَنَكِ قَبْلَ أَنْ يَخْلُقَكِ. He tested you before he created you. Allah Akbar. What does it mean? Allah tested Zahra before he created her. What is the logic that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will create someone and test that Allah will test someone before he created them? How? No, Imam was meaning that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tested Zahra in Alam al-Dhar before she came to this world. Our test is in this world. Zahra and Ahlul Bayt alayhi wasalam, their test was not started from here. Their test started from Alam al-Dhar. And when you read Dua al-Nudba, al-Imam talks about this all in that. Zahra alayhi wasalam, he said, imtahanaki fawajadaki sabira. Allah tested her in that Alam and he found her the most patient. Now let me just break down what is the test that Allah is talking about and the Imam is talking about. Have you ever seen a person to go through difficulty tests like Zahra? Well, there's nobody like Zahra who went through difficulty. Let me break down into one pieces at a time. Number one, Zahra was a woman who lived a life where she, what she faced, she saw her father went through difficulties with the baby. When she saw her father brought this religion, this deen to people, and people turned against her father. And she has to watch that. Sometimes her father will go to Ta'if and come back all covered with blood. Sometimes a father will go out to preach and he come back with the trash on him. How would you feel if your father is going through this? How would you feel if that father of mine or yours is not really, no, it's Rasulullah. That's one thing she would do. And then the father died. After the father died, she lost her mother and Khadija. In which situation? Where the mother died in a year where the entire Quraysh refused to sell or buy or give anything to them. And this poor lady, who was the richest woman among the Arabia, she turned to become the most poorest woman in Arabia. To the point where the narration said the night that Khadija passed, the Prophet couldn't have even enough kafan to cover her own body. Jibreel came down with the 5 kafan to Rasulullah. The first kafan the Prophet asked, who are the 5 kafan for? I just needed one for Zahra. He said, yes, but the 5 are for different people. The first one belongs to whom? He said, la, the Khadija, it's for Khadija, who's needed right now. The second kafan belongs to whom? For you, Ya Rasulullah. The third kafan for whom? For Amir al-Mu'mineen. The fourth kafan is for whom? For Imam al-Hassan alayhi salam. The fifth kafan is for whom? Allahu Akbar. He said, for Zainab alayhi salam. So what about Hussein? Say, Amma al-Hussein, fala kafan. Imam Hussein has no kafan. Why? لأنه يقتل بأرض يقال له كربلاء بلا غسل ولا كفن. رسول الله died on that day. That year, Zahra عليه السلام witnessed his father. Is that all the tragedy? No. Then after that, she herself have to experience it. You know, sometimes your family go through tragedy, but not yourself. No, Zahra alayhi salam, her mother went through it, her father went through it, and down herself. When they attacked her house, they burned the house, they broke her back, she lost her baby. All of this, Zahra alayhi salam. Is that all? No. Now your husband have to go through that too. And every one of these, they're related to Zahra alayhi salam. One is her father, one is her mother, one is her husband, Imam Ali alayhi salam. That years later after Zahra alayhi salam, her husband, Imam Ali alayhi salam, in the masjid while he was praying, he was attacked and struck. And 3 days later he was... Is that all? Is that death? No, no, no. Then her children also have to pay the price also. After Imam Ali alayhi salam, then Imam al-Hassan alayhi salam was poisoned. Then he has to go through that tragedy too. Is that all? No. Then Imam Hussein alayhi salam have to go through. All of this is one person. Zahra alayhi salam, she has to experience all of this from her family. And that is why some of the Mufassireen, like in Surah Tafsir Nur al-Thaqalayn, he mentioned when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, حَمَلَتْهُ وَهْنًا عَلَىٰ وَهْنًا. وَهْن means she carried him on weakness and witness. Weakness. And they said that was Zahra alayhi salam. The moment she got to her, she heard that her son Imam Hussein will be killed in the land called Karbala. And that puts Zahra into weakness for the rest of which mother out there would like to hear what would happen to her son like Imam Hussein? But she knew that. She had that from Rasulullah. And she has to deal with it for the rest of her life. And that is why when Quran, when Imam said, Mumtahana, Allah tested her. فَوَجَدَكِ صَابِرَ. Allah found you in Alam al-Dhar that you were patient. You know, the night that Zahra alayhi salam gave birth to Imam Hussein alayhi salam, and Jibreel came to give congratulations to the Prophet. And then the Prophet was told by Jibreel what will happen to Imam Hussein alayhi salam. The Prophet didn't want Zahra to hear that because he didn't want to break her heart. But the Zahra heard it anyway. Then she came to the Prophet. Ya Rasulullah, I heard something. What did he hear, Zahra? She says, Samitu Jibreel yaqul, أَنَّ هَذَا الْوَلَدِ this son will be killed in the land called Karbala.
Then she asked, Ya Rasulallah, awatakunu lak? Would you live to be there, to be,
to support him at least?
And the Prophet said, it will happen after one day. وَكَيْفَ أَمِيرُ الْمُؤْمِنِينَ وَمَتْ إِمَامُ خَلِيدٍ His father will be there? He said, no.
What about me? Would I be there to see what would happen to my son?
Then he said, no, you are not. What about my son Hassan? Would he be there to at least have a moral support for my son? Ya Rasulullah, who else will be there? He said, Zainab will be the only one to lead. And is that hard? Then he said, no. Ya Zahra, she busted into tears when she heard this. Then the Prophet said, Ya Zahra, Inna Allah sayakhluq. Allah will create certain people who will love you and love Hussein. And they will cry for Hussein as much as you will cry for them.
And from that day, when Zahra makes salat, only she said, Allahumma arham shi'ati, shi'ati.
Ya Allah, have mercy upon those shi'a who will cry for my son. On the day we will not be there to cry for Hussein.
And that's what Imam Hassan Ali said, every time I hear my mother make dua, she said, Shi'atuna, mu'mineen, and mu'minat.
Pray for those people, not for herself. Because she knew what will happen on those people, on her son, and who will come and cry for her son. And that dua of Zahra on that day will accept it too.
That today, when you go to every corner of the earth, every corner of the earth, you see people were crying for Hussein, Ya Hussein.
In the places that you never even imagined. You never even thought the name of Imam Hussein will get there, it has got. All because of the dua of Zahra. That is the tragedy that Zahra went through. Even after the Prophet died, Zahra alayhi salam will go to the grave and sleep on that grave and started crying. And she says, ماذا على من شم تراب محمد? What will happen to he who smelled the sand where Muhammad was buried? And then she turned and looked and she said, Ya Rasulullah, where are you? To see how quick things have turned right after your death. When you were there, this was different.
Now that you left,
things have changed. Look at how you treat us. They attack your house. They burn the house. The house where Rasulullah,
when you read Hadith al-Kisa, Jibreel, when he came down, Allah gave him permission. Where Jibreel asked Allah, Ya Rabbi, ata'adhanu li an ahbita ila al-ard li akuna ma'hum sadisa.
Allah said, adhintula. He got permission. He came down. Before he get to the house, he asked permission from the Prophet.
Ya Rasulullah, ata'adhan.
I need permission. Every one of them, Imam Hassan, Imam Hussein, Imam Ali, they all got permission before they entered that. But what happened? Rasulullah himself, whenever he come to that house, he always asked permission.
Zahra used to tell him, Ya Rasulullah, al-bintu bintu, al-karimatu karimatu.
Ya Rasulullah, udkhul. Ya Rasulullah, the house is your house, is door, the door is your door. Why do you need permission?
Okay.
And Rasulullah said, Ya Zahra, Inna Allah amarani bi dhalik. Allah told me to ask permission before I come to your house. But that the same house, people came and they were
before they entered. Tariq al-Tabari tells us, there were six men who came and attacked the house. One of them at least got his incense and he says, Inna fiha Fatima. In that house there is Fatima.
And then the answer came, Wa in. So what? Then they attacked the house. Then they attacked Zahra and they burned the house and they broke her back. Zahra was behind the door, waiting to open the door when the door was attacked and there was a nail that broke her back where she couldn't stand anymore. That is when she screamed and called Asma. Ya Asma, ta'ali, asnidin. Please help me to stand. I can't stand. They broke my back. I lost my baby. Zahra alayhi salam. She cried, calling her father. أينك يا رسول الله؟ صبت علي مصائب لو أنها صبت على الأيام سرنا ليالي. يا رسول الله, come and witness the tragedies that have been put on me. Those tragedies, if they are to be placed on days, the days couldn't have handled it. The days would have turned to nights. Zahra was sitting in the house and crying every single day. And before her, the shahadah, she called Imam Ali alayhi salam. Ya Amir al-Mu'mineen, it's time for me to depart from this world. I'm leaving. But I have different requests from you.
What is it?
Bunch of lists.
The first one, Ya Amir al-Mu'mineen.
I said, if I meet when I die, faghassil me. I want you to wash me. That's you. Don't invite anybody else. Allah. And this has to do with the fiqh too. What Zahra was talking about, it has to do with fiqh.
He said, wakafini.
And I want nobody to put the shroud on me but you. Wasalli alayya. And pray with me. And she said, Ya Amir al-Mu'mineen, wa affi mawda akabari. Hide my grave. Please, don't let anybody to know where my grave is. And that is why some narration said, the night of burial, Imam Ali made 5 graves next to the grave. So nobody could tell which one is which out of the 5 graves. Till affi. I want it to be unknown. And she added something. وَإِذَا دَفَنْتَنِي فَدْفُنِّي لَيْلًا إِذَا نَامَتِ الْعُيُّ. When you are to bury me at night when people are asleep. Allahu Akbar.
Then he said, Ya Amir al-Mu'mineen.
He said, وَضَعْنِي فِي قَبْرِي بِيَدَيْكِ. I want you to put me in the with your hand. They say, after you bury me, فَقِفْ عَلَىٰ رَأْسِي. Stand by my head. وَقْرَأْ لِي أَكْثَرُ مِنَ الْقُرْآنِ. Give me as much as you can from the Qur'an. And she added, because at that point, that is what I need the most. And she added, I say, when a person dies, the most we need is the Qur'an on the night of death. On the night of death. Then she added, Ya Amir al-Mu'mineen, ولا تنسى, don't forget me. Come to my grave.
اقرأ لي سورتين من القرآن. There are 2 surahs that I love. They are my favorite surahs. I said, one of them, Surah Yasin, and Surah Al-Safar.
He said, come and read them for me because I love them. Allah. You know, I was searching, why does she love these 2 surahs much?
What is the wisdom? Because there's so many surahs, but why would Zahra pick these 2 surahs?
One of the reasons they say,
one of the hikmah,
because in those 2 surahs, there is a talk about qiyamah. And that was one of the favorite things of Zahra alayhi wasalam.
Zahra alayhi wasalam, she loved to hear about qiyamah. So she loved this surah, and she want Imam Ali to read this surah every night.
And Imam Ali used to come there every night to read the surahs. Until one night came where she said to Imam Ali, from tonight, please don't come. You can read the surah at home. There was an incident. The narration said Imam Ali came at night when Hassan and Hussein, they all asleep. He came, he was reading Surah Yasin. He read Surah As-Safat, he finished. The narration said, فَأَخَذَتْهُ الْغَفْوَى. He fell a short sleep at that time. فَإِذَا بِزَهْرَى. Then you saw Zahra. وَدُمُوءَهَا تَجْرِي. She was crying. Then Imam Ali asked her, Ya Zahra, mimma bukak. You asked me to come, and I did. And I'm reading 2 surah. 2 surah that are your favorite. Then Zahra said, no, Ya Abba Ali, Ya Abba Hassan. They said, yes. وَلَكِنِ الْقَسَرَ قَلِيلٌ. I have a broken heart. What is the reason? He said, while you're here, Al Hassan and Hussein, they woke up. And they went to my room, I'm not there. And they went to look after you, and you were not there.
فَصَارَ كَحَائِرَانَ They became confused, running from one room to another. I said, that scene broke my heart. Ya Ali, don't come anymore. Imam Ali alayhi salam left the scene, rushed to go and look at Hassan and Hussein. What they were going back and forth, looking for their mother. La Zahra was there to comfort them. No, Imam Ali alayhi salam. Imam Ali rushed home. He came and saw Al-Hassan and Hussein. They were holding hands, crying, Aina Ummuna Zahra, where is our mother Zahra? Because Al-Hassan and Hussein, they were so attached to their mother, Zahra alayhi salam. And after she was gone, they thought their father would be there, but that night, the incident happened, and Zahra said, don't come anymore. I lifted that responsibility. Read the surah from home. So when Hassan and Hussein wake up, they see you are there, Al-Ali. Imam Ali alayhi salam. This is the tragedy of Ahlul Bayt alayhi salam. That Zahra alayhi salam have to go through. Inna lillah wa inna ilayhi raji'un. وسيعلم الذين ظلموا أي منقلب ينقلبون والعاقبة للمتقين وصلى الله على محمد وآل محمد.